found in Jeremiah 17:14. That's Jeremiah 17:14. Heal me, O Lord, and I will be healed. Save me, and I will be saved, for you are the one I praise.
I want to welcome all of you today in the house of the Lord. And I want to remind you that we are here to worship God. We have a wonderful God. He is not just the King of the universe and the Creator, but He is our Father and Savior and friend. Isn't that nice? I want to welcome our visitors. Wherever you come from, you should not live there, you should live here. We hope you will feel the blessing of being here with us. Want to remind you that, so Randy already announced, I just want to again and again remind you that on the 27th this month, we start evangelism. And it will go on for 4 weeks, every weekend, Thursday night, Friday night, and Saturday night. We didn't put evangelism during the week because people have jobs and families. And we thought, if it's just Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, you'll be able to come. And it would be nice, even if you don't have a job or a responsibility, if it would be nice if you come and if you keep your eyes around. When you see visitors coming, talk to them. You don't need to teach them doctrines. You just need to say hello, to listen, and eventually to have a prayer for them. And that would make a world of difference, because we do believe in prayer, don't we? Before evangelism, a whole week, we will have a week of prayer that every morning at 6:30 and on, and every evening at 7 on, wherever you are, you remember to stop for a few minutes and pray for those people, that God would touch their hearts. And also that this evangelistic series would be a blessing for the church, that the church would be revived, the church would be alive and blessed. Would you agree with me? So between the 15th and the 22nd, starting next week, for a whole week, we pray every morning and every evening. You remember that? It's going to be in the bulletin, in the newsletter. It will be announced again. Starting next Sabbath, we start prayer. After next Sabbath, the following Tuesday, on the 25th, we will have 24-hour prayer. That will be Tuesday night through Wednesday night, 25th through 26th. And we will have a list here starting next Sabbath with openings of 1 hour during the day that we come and pray here, and 1 hour during the night that you will pray at home. Please sign up. Let's have at least 3, 4, 5 people for each opening, okay? It will be again in the bulletin, and it will be again announced. For evangelism, Elder David Parker, together with the personal ministry team, already started to assign responsibilities. There are not too many jobs. I mean, greeters, ushers, children program, registration table, parking, music, refreshments, and that's it. Not too many jobs, and not difficult jobs. But the second part of evangelism, we will need to do a lot of visiting. And this is the covenant that I make with you. If you want to do a visit, I will go with you first time, and second time you go alone. Is that fair? I will go with you first time, but second time you go alone. And you just go there not to teach. We forbid you. We will take some measures against you if you go to teach. We got to think about what. Maybe you got to give some green beans, or you'll find a way. But you don't go there to teach. You go there to listen and pray for people. We do the teaching here, okay? Is that right? Okay, so it makes it easy for you. Saying that, I'm going to... Please read your bulletins, because there are many events happening this month. Read your bulletins. We spend money on this paper and time and work. Please read your bulletins. Saying that, let's bow our heads again for a word of prayer. Father, again, we pray that you open the word for us and you will be the one speaking to our hearts. In Jesus' precious name and merits, amen. For the last few Sabbaths, we started a subject in this great, big, difficult area called healing. And we started with James chapter 5. And we said that at the end of the book of James, James is asking three questions. The first question was, is anyone among you suffering? And we said that in Greek, the translated word is not suffering, but the translation is attacked by Satan, attacked by the evil one. Is anyone among you attacked by Satan? And we said that James gave one single solution, and that was pray, not regular prayer, but the way Jesus prayed in Gethsemane. The word for prayer there is desperate, fervent, begging, not letting go, like Jacob. Pray fervent prayer. There is no other solution. Second question that James is asking is, he actually says, is anyone among you, the Bible says cheerful, other translations happy, other translations merry, but the Greek says, is anyone of you having a good day, being blessed, keeping being positive? And there is one single advice. The word is psalo or salo, that is translated in two ways. Sing scripture, songs of praise. And if you look that word up in the Bible, we said it's used for a song that you write when you have an experience with God. And that's the song of your deliverance, the song of your experience, what God has done for you. You write it down and you sing it. But it's translated in two ways. Sing scripture songs of praise, or write it down, store it up, in order to pull it out, to recall it later when you go to trials. Like Joseph, in the 7 years of plenty, he stored everything. So when the trials would come, he would have reserves. Like the five wise virgins, they had something stored up. They had some reserve for the difficult time. If you don't store it up now, what are you going to do when the difficult time comes? So, are you having a good day? Are you blessed? Memorize it and then repeat it and tell it. Others would be blessed and it's going to help you too. So, when the difficult time comes, you'll praise the Lord still. And that was the second question. Is anyone among you having a good day? The third question, we started to talk about it last time. It says, is anyone among you sick? And we are tempted to think it's about physical sickness. But the word asthenia, refers to being weak, feeble, without strength. That's the correct translation. Is anyone among you feeling any kind of weakness? Do you feel that you are without strength? And that, in the Bible, it's used 33 times, just 9 times for physical weakness, all the other for any type of weaknesses, like 2 Corinthians chapter 12, Paul says, when I am asthenio, when I am without strength, when I am weak, then I am strong. He doesn't talk about, when I am sick, I have a flu, oh, I am strong. He refers there to pure spiritual struggle. When I am weak, when I am without strength, when I don't do what I want to do and I do what I don't want to do, and I hate myself and I am fighting and I get no victory, I go to the Lord and then I am strong. In my weakness, I learn that He is my strength. That's what Paul, I can do all things in Him. That's what he refers, using the same word, asthenio. That means being without strength in a variety of areas. Could be spiritually, could be physically, could be emotionally, could be relationally, could be a variety of areas. When I feel that I am weak and struggling in a certain area of my life, I go to the Lord and I am strong. That was our third question from James chapter 5, verse 13 to 15. Now, we are going to continue this third question. So, he says what we said last time, and we'll pick up from there. He says, he somehow quotes two words from John chapter 8, verse 36. If the Son makes you free, you shall be free indeed. Well, let me give you another verse. You shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. Then let me ask you, what is the truth? Is it the doctrines? Knowing the right doctrines? You remember we have seen his glory, the glory as of the one coming from the Father, full of grace and truth. Well, Jesus actually gives the answer. He says, I am. So the truth is not about knowing the right doctrines. The truth, it's about knowing the giver of the doctrines. It's about the one who is the truth. It's about not a theory, but it's about a person. And therefore, the Bible says, to know him, in John 17, is eternal life. Because those who really know Jesus, at least a glimpse of his love and grace and character, they are free indeed. To know him means total freedom, a peace that would surpass any understanding of any human peace. You follow me so far? To know Jesus is to know the truth. To have Jesus is to have the truth. It's not to have the right speech that you may say a bunch of words but live differently. But it's to have Jesus living in your mind and heart, moving in you. He is at the door, knocking, trying to move inside and dwell with you. It is God's desire from the beginning to live with us. Emmanuel, God with us. So picking up from this point, Jesus is the truth. And if we know him, he will give us strength in any type of weakness. And without him, we are nothing. Listen carefully. We are not chained by our pain, by our enemies, or our past. We are chained by the lies we believe. We are chained by the lies Satan wants you to believe, and he is sending to you all the time, 24/7, because he is the father of lies. He is a liar. He doesn't want us to know Christ the way Christ is, because when we know Christ, we are free. But believing a bunch of lies, regardless if it's about relationships with people, oh, you know what that one said about you? Or about self, this is how I am. I will never do that. I am unable. I don't deserve it. Satan wants you to believe that you don't deserve it. Satan wants you to believe that you are not able. Satan wants you to believe that you are hopeless, because a hopeless Christian is a lost Christian. Satan wants you to believe all type of lies, and that's what chains us. And to know the truth about Jesus is to be free. Therefore, as we continue today, is anyone among you feeling weak, without strength in any area? This is what you need to do. And it starts with knowing the truth, knowing Jesus. And let's explain it a little. The Greek word without strength means to be weak in any type of area in your life. But then he says, what shall you do? Let him call the elders. Okay, we know so far. Pray for him, anoint him with oil in the name of the Lord. And, hold on a second, let's explain so far and then we'll continue, okay? Let him call the elders. In Greek translation, it refers to elders, pastors, deacons. Well, why call the elders? Do you think that if the pastor comes, you are going to be healed just because the pastor comes? I've been to many places and prayed and nothing happened. And I prayed for people from far away distance and things happened. And there are situations in which I didn't pray for people. One of the church elders prayed for them, didn't even call me. And that person got healed. And in the beginning I said, why didn't he call me? He doesn't like me anymore? But then I said, hey, praise the Lord, he got healed, you know? Why call the elders? You see, I want to remind you that the miracle is not done by the elder or by the deacon or by the pastor, because they pray in the name of the Lord. Your favorite pastor is not going to do the miracle. Okay? Let him call the elders, pray for him, and anoint him with oil. Well, by the way, this is not alcohol. This is oil. Okay? Pure, virgin, cold-pressed olive oil. $2.98. Okay. Anoint him with oil. What is here? I just told you. Olive oil, regular olive oil. If somebody would call you and say, hey, I have some sanctified oil, send me $50 and I'm going to send you a small jar of sanctified oil. Please save the money or give them to the church. And go to the grocery store and get $2.98 regular olive oil, okay? Because oil doesn't do the healing. Oil is what? It's a symbol of what? Of? Come on, church. The Holy Spirit, absolutely. Olive oil is the symbol of the Holy Spirit. I mean, by the way, there was a joke in Romania. I'm sorry, doctors and physicians. I'm not talking about you here. There was a joke in Romania about some doctors that didn't do a good job. You go to them and you say, I have a headache, they give you a Tylenol. You say, I have a stomach pain, they give you a Tylenol. You say, I broke my leg, yet they give you a Tylenol. I'm not talking about old, I'm sorry, now I cannot call them anymore. They said, uh-huh, this is what you said in your sermon. Go to somebody else. Oil, you put it on, the Bible says, on your forehead. What about if you have a broken leg? How is it going to work from forehead to the leg? It's not about oil. In fact, there are examples in the Bible when the miracle was performed without anointing, without oil. For instance, Peter is going to the temple. You remember? And there is a paralyzed, a crippled man at the entrance in the temple. And he has his hand out asking for money. Can you help me, please? Because he didn't know Jesus. If he knew Jesus, he would have asked for something different. And Peter says, I'm sorry, I forgot the oil at home. Did he say so? Not in my Bible. Peter says, let me run home, take a taxi, come back with the oil. I will anoint you and then you'll be healed. You know, the oil. He doesn't say so. Peter says, money, gold and silver, I don't have. But I do have something. I have Jesus. In the name of Jesus, get up and walk. Without any oil. And the man gets up and he walks. The miracle performed without oil. Because church, the power, the healing doesn't happen by the oil. Oil is just a symbol through which you say, Lord, I acknowledge. I mean, oil doesn't make much sense. Doesn't make any sense. You are sick and put some oil on the forehead. Come on, church. It's kind of saying, Lord, I am without power. I have no solution. So I come to you. Would you please do a miracle in my life and in my body and in my mind or whatever may be your weakness, emotional or whatever. Would you please do this for me? And then putting the oil, you say, I need the power of your spirit to touch my body and my heart and my mind and my life. That's the symbol. It's so simple. So, continuing, I'm going to give you an example. At a certain point in my ministry, I was in Wisconsin, and I didn't feel like much going on. And I was not breaking the fifth or the sixth or the seventh or the tenth commandment. I mean, the tenth, once in a while, you see a nice car, a motorcycle, you know, but the others not. I was not breaking the commandments. I was visiting people, preaching, doing my work, but I was not sick physically, I was strong, but nevertheless, I felt the need of the Holy Spirit to renew me and give me strength and give me a new desire, a new passion. So we had a pastor's communion at the conference office, and the president asked, anybody wants to be anointed? And I went there. And one of the pastors had a back pain, one of them a leg pain. And he asked me, what is hurting in your body? I said, nothing. It's just in my heart. And I got anointed. And I felt God's power coming back. And I felt that desire. And it refreshed in my mind the call that God gave me when I was 4 years old. And I said, yes, I'll keep going. So anointing doesn't just, I remember another pastor telling me that he was visiting a lady and she used to be an elder, but she was by now about 78 and she was retired and hardly going to church because she was in a wheelchair, and he prayed for her and she said, pastor, did anybody anoint you lately? And he says, no, but I am not sick. And she says, pastor, you should better check your Greek. It's not just about physical sickness, pastor. It's about everything. How are you doing with your heart and your call and your emotions and your relations? I said, well, I could do better. And she says, wait here. And she rolls the wheelchair in the kitchen. She brings a big bottle of olive oil. And she says, kneel down. And she pulls the whole bottle. I mean, And he says, that's not the way to do it. Too much. And she says, isn't God pouring his blessing abundantly over you? Isn't God pouring his blessings abundantly over you? Let the Holy Spirit come abundantly. He says, but this is just oil. It's a symbol. It's a symbol. And he says, telling me the story, he felt nothing that moment, but he felt that night in prayer that God came back and took over again. It's just a symbol. Well, moving on. So call the pastor or the elders. Have them anoint you with oil. And there is something else there. It says, pray over you. What type of prayer, church, you remember? The prayer that Jesus prayed in Gethsemane. There are two words for prayer. It's not the regular prayer. It's the fervent, determined, passionate, desperate prayer. Have them pray for you. And it says like this, listen carefully. The prayer of faith will restore the sick. Well, I have a problem with that. I looked in the Greek. And I checked 5 different translations. None of them say the same thing. Listen. One of them says restore. One of them will make him well. One of them will make him whole. One of them would heal him. Come on, which one is the one? So the Greek word is sozo. In translation, it has about 7, 8, 9 translations. So basically, they didn't know which one to pick. And I didn't either. So what I am going to do? I'm going to give you all of them. Because I checked in my Bible, and the word is used many times. And every time it's a different one. This time is this, this time is that. So this time is not that usually, like out of 50, 40 times, the Bible uses this word this way. Every time is different. So I'm going to give you all of them a new pick. Is that fair? So, the prayer of faith will make him how? Sozo. Let's translate it. Rescue him from destruction. The prayer of faith will rescue him from destruction. Second, the prayer of faith will keep him safe continually. Keep him safe. Third, the prayer of faith will save him eternally. Will save him eternally. Isn't that nice? To be saved now and from now on. As long as you remain in Christ, you are saved. The prayer of faith will heal him from any type of suffering. Isn't that nice? Next one. The prayer of faith will make him well. Next one. The prayer of faith will restore him to complete health. Wow! Complete health. Next one. The prayer of faith will save him from the evil one. Next one, the prayer of faith will deliver him from penalties. Powerful. And the last one, the prayer of faith will make him whole. Did you count them? I mean, not usually one word would have so many translations. This one, sozo, does. So the Bible translators were confused, and each one uses what he thinks is the best one. But in fact, this word, every time in the Bible, is used differently. So it could be any of them. My guess is that whatever you need, that's what God does through this word. You see the point? Whatever your situation may be, that's what would apply to you. And that's what God wants to do for you. Let him call the elders. Pray over him. Anoint him with oil. And the prayer of faith would do one of the above, or two, or all of the above. Isn't that nice? Would you want me to repeat them again fast? Sozo. The prayer of faith will rescue him from destruction, keep him safe, save him, heal him from suffering, make him well, restore him to health, save him from the evil one, deliver him from penalties, make him whole. Now, I did a mistake. I said him. I should have said her, not him, or him and her, or whatever, you know. Okay. So it refers to all areas, all needs, not just physical, not just spiritual, not just eternal, everything that you may need. I remember I have a cousin. His name is George. When he was young, he left the church. And he really left the church. I mean, you talk to him about God, he would curse and talk badly, and he would make fun, leave me alone, you know. And he got into smoking and alcohol and you name it, everything. Well, nobody could reach him. He was like, never, forget it. I don't need God in my life. Guess what? We were praying for him, so he was in trouble. As soon as we started to pray for him, a group of young people, things started to happen. The last of them, he was a driver of a big truck that works for hydrocentrals, those power houses on the river, that has a big thing in the back that would carry rocks. But it's, I don't know how many tons, but it's a big thing in the back. Big wheels, big machine. And he had an old broken truck. And the owner called him and said, you have done well, I'm going to give you a new truck. Go to the garage. This is the key. Pick up one of those 16 trucks. It was winter. It was ice all over. You would hardly walk. Your legs would go, you know. So he took the keys. He got into the new truck, and he said, I'm going to try the thing, a new car. He got into the truck, big engine, like a whole factory. Four, five, six. When he got into the sixth gear, the gate, a big steel gate right in front, brake, sideways. The truck hit the gate, broke the gate, hit the bridge, broke the bridge, fell off the bridge into the cabin. The whole weight of the truck compacted the cabin, and he was inside. It took them 2 hours to cut the doors and the cabin to get him out. When they got him out, the steering wheel was bent into his stomach. The leg was facing the back, and the bones coming shredded, broken through the flesh, coming out. They put him in ambulance. He was gone. He knew nothing. And in the ambulance, he had a vision, a dream, whatever, I don't know. He heard, nina, nina, nina. That was the ambulance, okay. He had a dream, like he saw red lights. Probably he opened his eyes. That was still real. But then the nina, nina, and the red lights stopped because somebody came dressed in white and in glory. And somebody said, it's time for judgment. What are you doing? So, by the way, I forgot the most important ingredient. When the owner of the company gave him the truck, that was a Saturday. Mom told him, today you should go to church. I said, church? There is no God. I hate God. I don't need God. Leave me alone. I want to see God. When you show me God face to face, then I come. So now back to the story. God was there and said, what are you doing here today? Shouldn't you be in church and worship me? I am waiting for you there. If you die today with this attitude going against me, what do you think is going to happen to you? And the dream went off. And he woke up at hospital. And he said, am I dead? Is the judgment done? Am I in heaven or hell? And then a nurse, no, you are still in hospital. And the doctor comes. And the doctor says, we'll save your life. But we cannot save your leg. We have to amputate. We have to cut your leg off. And he thinks about it. And he was just about 22 years old. And he says, Lord, would you, if I lose my leg, would you save my soul? Would you forgive me? Would you accept me back? And while he was praying, the nurse comes and says, what are you doing there? I'm praying. And he says, well, God is big. Though she was in a communist country, he said, God is big. He can do anything. He could save your leg. And he says, you know what? I wish he would, but right now I'm more concerned about my soul. And she says, hey, God can do everything. Don't ask small things. Don't ask. There is a quotation that says, we offend God when we ask small things. He can do everything. I mean, he just says and it happens. He can make you whole. Just ask him for everything. He says, I don't deserve it. And she says, guess what? You never did. You never did. Ask him in Jesus' merits, not in your merits. And he thought about it. And he said, give me a Bible. And she gave him a Bible. And he read there in Psalm where he says, if you are faithful, not one of your bones would be broken. Would have been broken. He closed the Bible and said, Lord, whatever happens to my leg, save my life. And if you want, save my leg too. If not, I'll still serve you. The doctor came back and said, we decided. We'll give it a try. We will not cut your leg off, but it's going to be shorter than the other one. Well, better than no leg. Well, they did a surgery, and his leg was shorter. And then they put a weight and a wheel and the weight there, and the leg would be up. I don't know if you know what I am talking about. 6 months later, he was walking in the leg. Today, he is about 52. His leg was never shorter. You don't know that he ever had an accident. He's in Georgia, in that big church, I forgot the name, North Atlanta. He is a member there, involved in church, Sabbath school, you name it, everything, a good Adventist. His leg was never shorter, but it turned him around. God can heal your soul. God can heal your mind. God can heal your body. God can do beyond and above what you ask, what you dream, what you imagine, beyond your greatest, most richest imaginations. Because God is God. And God loves us with a love that we will never fully understand. So therefore, this Bible verse could be translated in so many ways. But remember, the prayer of faith. Faith is essential, not because faith would obligate, would coerce, would force God. If I have faith, he has to do it. I have faith, now he must do it. No. God is not a servant. You say like Jesus, may your will be done. Faith is not to force God's will. Faith is to be able to receive God's miracle. You follow me? Faith is just a hand that would grab God's hand. Is how you accept and allow God to work. Is not how God works. God doesn't need your faith to do the miracle. You need your faith to receive what he has done. You follow me? Faith is not to force God. Faith is to accept what he gives you. Well, now listen carefully. We should need another sermon for this third subject. I think we do that. I think we stop and continue next time. No, next time is Dr. Clark and then Sabbath in Nature. There are three promises in this verse. and we just start touching on them. Number one, the prayer of faith will make you whole. Number two, the Lord will raise him up. And number three, if he has or she has committed sins, the sins will be forgiven. Well, it's a lot to talk right there. It's a lot to talk right there. So, doubting God limits God. Asking a little offends God. Faith is essential not to deserve, but to receive the blessing. Faith is a mental choice. Faith, I could give you quotations from the Spirit of Prophecy. I could give you Bible verses. Faith, it's a mental choice. You choose to believe without understanding, without deserving, based not on mathematics or science. Faith is not what you see. The word faith is the substance of things that we hope of, that we don't see. Substance, sub means from Latin, what is under and holds whatever is above. Stance is what is above. So faith is what is behind or under the Christian life and holds the whole Christian life together. Faith is what keeps you together when you don't understand what is going on in your life. Faith is putting your trust in God when you have no physical or scientific explanation, when you cannot see, when there is no light, there is no hope. It's a choice that you say, I am going to trust him regardless, like Job. I am going to trust him, not when things go well, at any time, regardless. That's faith. You make a choice, I'm going to trust the Lord. And faith could be like a mustard seed. Doesn't matter. God has given everyone a measure of faith. Everyone means how many? Everybody. But why is like a mustard seed? It's not about size. Could be mustard seed so small that you don't see it. It's about the properties of the mustard seed. The mustard seed would grow into a big tree if it's fed, if it's watered. Faith, if it's used, exercised. There is a quotation in the Spirit of Prophecy that says, faith exercised would grow. Faith, if it's used, is going to grow like a tree. Faith is what the choice that you make every day, to trust God. And as you see how he works today, how he works tomorrow, you'll trust him when more troubles would come. So, faith is essential. But the first promise is that the prayer of faith will make him whole, restore him, the word sozo that I gave you the translations. The second promise is that the Lord will raise him or her up. What means to raise him up? I'll try to cut it short so we finish today. The grammar is very simple. It's a present continuum. That means it's going to happen how many times? Continually. Today, tomorrow, every day, again and again. Well, I checked the grammar more carefully and I checked what the word is used in the Bible. And it says there, in several situations, one of them when Paul said, I am willing to live joyfully or to die joyfully for Christ. Did faith and prayer save Paul from being beheaded? Yes or no? So is it talking about physical being raised up? It seems to me that God has in mind more than that. He may raise you up physically, but he promises that he will save you. And even if he doesn't raise you up now, he will raise you up at the second coming. I told you last Sabbath about Doris. She was baptized with Herb, two of them elderly Lutherans, stubborn, I'm sorry. When I visited them first time, no, this is the way. I said, take your Bible, read that verse for me. Explain it to me. We don't know. Okay, what about this verse? We don't know. What about this one? Okay. Too many Bible verses. And they said, yeah, we kind of believe it's Sabbath. Why everybody worships Sunday? And we had a long discussion to make a long story short. Eventually, they took all the Bible studies. They got baptized. Next Sabbath after baptism, during the week, she went to the doctor. Next Sabbath, she told us that she has cancer in the last stage, and she just learned that week. We prayed for her, and we had faith, and she still died. And she asked me, Pastor, will I be healed? And I said, Doris, yes, you will be healed. I just don't know when. It could be today. It could be next month. Or you may have to go to rest as John the Baptist, as Paul, as many other saints did. And at the second coming, Jesus will raise you up. And that's a promise that Jesus makes to you. You follow me? We don't understand why, but God knows. But we know that God will raise him up, because in God's time, this life is nothing. It's not that he doesn't care. He does care even for our very hair, for those who have hair. It's not that God doesn't care. It's just that the most important part in the picture is that we spend eternity with him. Not that we get another 5 years here. He knows why, and we will understand in heaven. So, I could give you stories about all three situations. We were at camp meeting, we prayed for Shorty. His name is not Shorty, but he is so short that we all called him Shorty. All his life, he had back pain. He would sleep in a chair because he could not lay in the bed. We prayed for him, anointed him. That night, he went to bed and slept after 25 years, first time in a bed. And he had no pain since. Instantly healed. And then we prayed for my wife. She was sick for 12 years. She got discouraged and depressed about it. And she went to a million doctors. I'm exaggerating for sure. And nobody knew what is wrong. After 12 years, somebody in UW in Madison found out she had a surgery and she didn't have pain since. In that area at least. So it didn't work right away. It took about a long time. And then we prayed for my father, and we had faith. Nevertheless, he passed away. The prayer of faith will raise you up, but God knows when. It's just the promise that you can count that when Jesus comes, you will be raised up. But there is a third promise, and I want to move on. And if he, she has committed sins, it will be forgiven. I want you to understand, church, this. Jesus doesn't heal or touch one part of your life and will leave the others untouched. When he brings healing, he brings healing in all areas. They go together as a package. For instance, Psalm 103, bless the Lord, O my soul, bless the Lord and do not forget all his benefits. He forgives your sins, he heals your diseases. Do you see they come together? And which one comes first? Spiritual healing, forgiveness. Think about the paralyzed man that was lowered through the roof in front of Jesus, you remember? And Jesus said, forgiven are your sins. You are forgiven. And the Pharisees, who is this man that can forgive sins? And Jesus says, what is easier to say? For sure, for us it would be easier to say you are forgiven. But for God it's more difficult to say you are forgiven because it costs Jesus' life. So he says, in order to know that the Son of Man has the power to forgive sins, I tell you, take your bed and walk. And he did. Which one came first? Forgiveness. Church, physical healing doesn't come alone. In fact, it doesn't come, period, unless the spiritual healing happens first. Did you hear? Physical healing doesn't come, period, unless the spiritual healing comes first. We cannot go to God and say, heal me, and our life is a mess, and we don't need him in our life. We need to make peace with God. The Bible says very clear, confess your sins and you'll be forgiven. In fact, if you keep reading the next verse right there in James chapter 5, confess your sins to one another. And if you have committed sins, you'll be forgiven. Confess your sins to one another if you have done something to one another. Confess your sins to God if you have done something against God. Ask forgiveness. And when you receive forgiveness, then you receive physical healing. You cannot just ask God, give me that, but I don't need you. Like you have a kid and says, give me money to buy a car, but leave me alone. Don't visit me. I hate you. You want that type of kid? So, why shouldn't everybody be anointed? We all have some type of weakness or pain or... Verse 16 in James 5, confess your trespasses to one another. Pray for one another. And then, it says in the English, that you may be healed. In Greek, and then you can ask for healing. It's a lot more clear in Greek. Confess to one another, pray for one another, and then you can ask for healing. Do you see, church, why healing may not happen at times? Well, at times it's not God's will, but many times it is God's will. We just don't do what we are supposed to do. We don't go the proper steps. Lord, would you please forgive me? I have done this and that. Would you please forgive me? Would you please? And then I go to my wife or to my son or to my brother or to my sister. I've done this against you. Would you please forgive me? Whatever they do is their business. But you did your part. And the Bible is very clear. It's a covenant between you and God. If you confess, God is faithful and just to forgive and to cleanse. You do your part, God will do his part. If you confess, that's your part, God will forgive and cleanse. That's his part. Confess. And in the moment you confess, you are forgiven. And then you can ask for healing. Because God would heal your soul and then your body and your emotions and so on. So, church, it's a conditional. Confess to one another. Pray for one another. And this is the prayer of faith. So listen carefully. Confess, pray with faith, and you'll be healed. So, church, it ends this way. The effective prayer of the righteous avails much. Let me ask you, who is the righteous? The pastor. Nah, I wish I could say that. I know just one that is righteous. And that's Jesus Christ. Would you agree with me? He is indeed righteous. Because there is no other name under heaven that we can be saved in. There is no other name in heaven that you pray and can do what Jesus can do for you. Therefore, we anoint in Jesus' name. Therefore, we pray in Jesus' name. Because there is no salvation except through Jesus. He is the Alpha and Omega. He is the great healer. He is everything. He is the righteous one. But the good news, church, is that Jesus says, I will pray for you. What is Jesus doing in heaven right now? It says in the book of Hebrews, praying, making intercession for you. He told Peter, I am praying for you. Didn't you know that, Peter? He is telling you, I am praying for you day and night, 24/7. That's what Jesus is doing right now. He says in the Bible. So let me tell you two things. The Bible says whenever two or three ask something, it will be given. Jesus is praying for you. Secondly, when you ask forgiveness, in that moment, you are forgiven. In that moment, your sin goes over Jesus and his righteousness entirely comes over you. So in that moment, you are righteous. So if you put your life in order, there are at least two praying. Because you ask forgiveness, you are righteous, so it's you and Jesus. Isn't that nice, church? The prayer of the righteous. Don't go to God asking things without asking forgiveness. With desire and honesty and humbleness, put your life in order. Therefore, when we do anointing, we ask people, we give them time to search their hearts and put their life in order. We don't just go and in boldness, God, give me that. We don't do that. Put your life in order. And then in humbleness, we say, would you, Lord, please? And anoint. Because it's God's power. And we don't deserve it. So do you see the point, church? The prayer of the righteous avails much. And what are the promises? Sozo, that means a bunch of things. In fact, affecting every area, every need, regardless. Spiritual, eternal, physical, whatever. will make you whole. Number two, the Lord will raise you up. What a promise. And number three, your sins will be forgiven. And the promise is that prayer will be answered. The way we don't know, it would be wrong to presume, to assume that God is going to work right now, always. But He answers every honest prayer. It may be now, it may be in time, it may be a second coming, but He does answer every single honest prayer, because He says, whatever you ask in my name, it shall be given to you. It's a promise, and God doesn't lie. I put in your bulletins, or we gave you later, a paper with paragraphs. I would ask you to take that paper at home and don't trash it. Read it. It has about each subject that we touched today. Everything that we touched, actually talked about today, it has one paragraph. If you digest them slowly, if you eat them at home, you'll get a great blessing. It's there for you. Take it home and praise the Lord. So, church, oh, by the way, I remember, and I'll not give the story. When I had allergy, I prayed like for 11 months, and I didn't get an answer. And one night, I prayed like life and death prayer, and I didn't get an answer. But that morning, my big spots became small, and within 4 or 5 days, they disappeared and never came back. After that whole night, from night to morning, the whole night of prayer. So God answered, but slowly. I could give you a bunch of stories, we don't have time. Church, some of you, as you listen or on the internet, you may feel that you need to be made whole. I'm going to ask Judy to play something, and I will ask you to open in hymnals song 314. 314. Some of you, 314, may feel the need to be made whole. Some others may feel the need for prayer. By the way, we have prayer Wednesday night and Friday morning. Plus, you can start a prayer group right in your house, starting with your family. Some of you may be physically weak or struggling. Some of you may be emotionally or spiritually or whatever other areas, relationships, struggling. Some of you may feel the need to be anointed. Some of you may be well, but you may know somebody who needs some strength. If you have any type of these struggles, right now, I ask you to enter a covenant. Enter a covenant with the Lord that from now on, you make every day a new commitment, that every morning and every evening you make peace with God. And you ask Him to make you whole. And you ask Him to raise you up. And you ask Him for forgiveness. And you ask Him that He makes you a blessing for the others that don't know these things, to the point that this church will become a blessing for people and for the community, to the point that this church will become a blessing for our families, that this church would be a church of prayer, powerful prayer, that in this church God's presence will be sensed every time. When people come here, people will know that this is a church of prayer, a house of prayer, and God is here. So I'm asking you right now, in quiet prayer, to try to make order with God. And after you finish praying for about 1 minute, quietly, I will say amen. Then you go into the second prayer and ask Him to make you whole, to touch your life. And after that, I will have a closing prayer. Would you do that, please? I'm going to softly sing together with some of you 314, first stanza. And after that we go into prayer. 314. Let's sing. Just as I am without one plea, but that was shed for me, and thou bidst me come to thee, O Lamb of God, I come, I come. Let's pray quietly and ask God for forgiveness and for His presence. Amen. Call upon me in the day of your trouble and I will deliver you and you will praise me. Let's go into the second prayer and ask God to make us whole. Amen. Call me and I will answer you and show you great and mighty things which you don't know. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, we thank you so much for these wonderful promises. And we know your promises are all yes and amen. And we believe. We believe that you can, you want, and you answer our humble prayers. Father, we ask forgiveness and cleansing. We all have already done that. And we believe the promise that if we confess our sins, you are faithful and just and gracious and good and merciful to forgive and to cleanse us. And we believe we have been forgiven. We praise you. Father, right now we ask for healing in every area. If somebody is physically sick, please touch them. If somebody has emotional trouble, emotional struggles, please touch them. If somebody right now has any type of weakness, probably something in relationships, something in any other areas, please touch them. If somebody is struggling spiritually, please touch them. Answer our prayers, not based on our merits, but based on Jesus' merits, because we pray in His name. Make us whole. And Father, may we soon spend eternity with you. We pray in Jesus' name. And we know that you answer these prayers because you promise so. And in faith, without understanding, without deserving, we don't need to feel it. In faith, Father, in anticipation, based on your word, we praise you, we thank you, and we love you. And everybody says, Amen.